From the patient files of Dr. William Wickman, director of Hillbrook Insane Asylum. Patient 471, Alice Watson, aka the Living Shadow. 471 is a tough case indeed. The patient insists that she isn't a human being, but merely a living shadow, hence the nickname. The patient has to be restrained at all times due to her penchant for attempting suicide. She takes any chance given to try and end her life. According to 471, killing herself is the only way for her to go home, as she puts it. We constantly have to keep her sedated as well, as at the moment we unfortunately don't have enough staff to always be watching her. And as we've learned from the past, restraints aren't necessarily enough to keep these people from killing themselves. Or others. Funnily enough, patient 621, who was just returned to us following his little adventure on the outside, offered to help me out by keeping an eye on 471. Needless to say, I rejected the offer, generous as it was. Yes, I simply don't know what to do with poor Alice Watson. With her background, it was inevitable she would end up disturbed in some way. But who could have guessed it would go this far? Probably not her parents. If they had, they would surely not have forced such a life upon her. By the time Alice had turned 21, both of them had passed away, and as per their wishes, she thus became the sole caretaker of her older brother, Jack. Jack had been mentally challenged since birth, and also suffered from various psychoses. I suspect the crazy ran in the family. Anyway, for years, it was just the two of them, Alice and Jack, living together in the family house. It was a dark and empty house, fairly isolated from the rest of civilization. During this time, Alice had minimal real-life contact with the rest of the world, only enough to receive the proper medicine and other aid for her brother. After 10 years of this, Jack passed away too. Alice was of course distraught, and in fact felt completely lost. However, after a while, she began to realize the opportunity this turn of events presented. She was now free. Free to flee the house and do whatever she wanted. At first, it naturally felt frightening. But soon, Alice began to fill up with wonder and excitement. She was 31 years old, and now she was finally going to start living. Leaving the old house behind, she took all the money she had and moved to the city. She was able to get a small apartment for a reasonable price, and there she settled in. It was located in the middle of the city, an area full of life and noise, far from what she was used to. Naturally, it took some adjusting, but eventually Alice began to greatly enjoy it, and wouldn't have it any other way. While caring for Jack, Alice had received payments from the state. They were just happy they didn't have to bother and find some kind of home for him. This way, he was someone else's problem. Now though, Alice was forced to find a new job. She had no education and had in fact never gone to school whatsoever. Her parents had provided homeschooling for her. This did not mean she was unintelligent, however. Alice was actually rather bright. Their homeschooling wasn't bad, and following their absence, she used technology to learn more. She also read many books, as there wasn't much else to do for fun in the house. Still, she had no formal education, no graduation papers. She also completely lacked experience in the work field, so getting a new job wasn't the easiest task. Eventually, she was able to find an elementary school that needed a new janitor, a job that required nothing whatsoever, except that you knew your way around a mop. Alice took the job. At the age of 31, she finally got to go to school. Her co-worker was a woman in her 50s, not too far off from retirement. Her name was Mary, and she had basically worked at the school her entire adult life. Alice got along with her very nicely, despite their age difference. Alice wasn't very much like women her own age anyway. In many ways, she was far older than her years. She also got along very well with the kids at the school, and sometimes joined them in their games. In many ways, Alice was also far younger than her years. Mary had a son, Nick, who was about Alice's age. She talked about him very often. One day, when the two were having their lunch break, Mary suddenly asked if Alice was single. Apparently Nick was, much to Mary's chagrin. A struggling writer, he hadn't had the time to find himself a wife, or he felt he wasn't financially secure enough for the task yet. Mary wasn't quite sure which it was. She would often nag him about grandkids, however, to which he responded with annoyance. Alice replied that she was indeed single, and Mary got a big grin on her face. She could tell immediately what Mary was thinking, but she didn't really mind. In fact, why shouldn't she go on a date with Nick? Alice was human after all, like the rest of us, despite what she would say now, that is. Isolated in that house for so many years, it's a given she had yearned for a fella many a nights. 31 years old and she hadn't even kissed a boy. In fact, you can bet your bottom dollar her desire for a mate was stronger than any other desire she had. Having been shown pictures of Nick, she knew he was fairly handsome, so she agreed to a date. She agreed so eagerly, Mary barely had time to ask the question. Of course, the question remained if Nick would agree, but Mary said she'd get him to agree. She'd make sure of it. And Alice was fairly attractive herself too, so why wouldn't he? Well, as she found out the next day, it turned out that he did agree. Just what exactly Mary did to make this happen, if anything, she never found out. Anyway, the evening of the date eventually came. Nick and Alice were going to meet at a restaurant, as is common for dates. Or so I'm told. I'm a very busy man, I don't have time to date. They were supposed to be there at 8 o'clock. Alice was there 40 minutes too early. She was just so nervous she couldn't sit around at home and simply wait. The wait just made it worse. The crippling anticipation. She had to get out, actually get to the place and get the date started, even though it hadn't officially started yet. It was funny, Alice was far more nerve-wracked over this date than she had been over moving to the city, getting her own apartment, getting a job. She sat there in the restaurant by herself for half an hour, too anxious to even nibble on some bread, until Nick showed up at 7:50. After greeting each other, he asked if she'd been waiting long. She said she only got there a couple of minutes ago. Alice was very stiff and felt incredibly awkward. That is, until wine was served. She had never been much of a drinker, but now alcohol turned out to be a blessing in disguise, as after just a few sips, she began to feel far more relaxed. She was then able to actually enjoy the date. The two talked mostly about literature, naturally, as he was a writer and she was an avid reader. Alice avoided bringing up her past and made no mentions of her brother Jack. She didn't want to talk about it. She would rather just forget that part of her life, like it had never even happened. This was a new day, a completely new Alice Watson living an entirely different life. In fact, she was already starting to have trouble remembering her old existence in that house. It was like her mind had begun to repress all those depressing events. She wasn't even quite sure how Jack had passed away any longer. Anyway, what a topic that would have been to bring up. When Nick asked about her family, she even lied and said she was an only child. She'd tell him the truth sometime in the future, once they'd gotten closer. After the date was over, which she at least felt had been a success, he walked her home. Proving that it wasn't just her and he was feeling it too, Nick leaned in and gave her a kiss, right on the lips too. And finally, Alice had gotten her first kiss. It's never too late for anything. Later that night, Alice had trouble sleeping. Not because of worry or anxiety, because she was so filled with joy. All of it, the apartment, the job, Mary, the kids, and now Nick, of course. It all really did feel like a dream. Was this really her life? Was it really she who was living all of this? Alice could hardly believe it. In a very short time, her entire life had changed completely. Then a scary thought forced itself into her mind. What if it really was all a dream? And she'd wake up from it at any minute, still in that house, with no one else but Jack. Jack and the shadows. Alice quickly brushed off this nasty thought though, and shortly fell asleep. Alice was awoken in the middle of the night by a noise. It was coming from inside her apartment. She quickly sat up in bed and with senses still blurred from sleep, tried to pinpoint and identify the noise. It was completely dark in the apartment. She didn't dare turn on the lights, afraid she would attract whoever or whatever was making the noise. She couldn't see anything, but the sound of the noise was becoming clearer. It was coming from the living room. It was the sound of footsteps, going back and forth, out in the living room. The cheap wood flooring creaked with each step. A burglar, Alice assumed. She tried to reach for her phone on the nightstand but couldn't find anything in the darkness. She then accidentally knocked over the night lamp, causing a loud noise in her room. Alice froze on the bed. The footsteps stopped. It became eerily silent out in the living room. This was even worse than the footsteps. No door could be heard opening, so whoever it was out there was still there. Alice's eyes grew wide, desperately trying to make something out in the darkness. Her heartbeat kicked up a few gears, and her hands began to drip with sweat. She listened intently for any noise, but nothing could be heard. Until, suddenly, the footsteps began again, now much louder, much closer. In fact, they weren't coming from outside the living room at all any longer. They were coming from right inside the bedroom. They were right next to her. She turned to look around the room, but it was so dark. But then she saw it. A quick glimpse of it. A shadowy silhouette of a man, walking in and out of view to her left, disappearing and reappearing from the shadows. Alice leaped off the bed and slammed on the ceiling lamp. The entire room was bathed in light, as was the man. But, to Alice's shock, he was, despite this, still completely cloaked in shadows. The man had stopped moving and stood still, staring at her. Or at least she assumed he was staring at her. He was face her way, but no actual features could be made out on his face. All of them, from head to toe, was entirely pitch black, as dark as the night itself. It wasn't dark clothes he was wearing, it was he himself. Alice ran out of the room in panic, ripped open the front door and fled the apartment. From a neighbor she called the police, and they arrived promptly, searching through the apartment for the bizarre man. However, no trace of him was found. He was completely gone. No evidence of breaking and entering could be found either. It was like he had come from nowhere and disappeared into nowhere. Alice hadn't told them what he looked like. She couldn't see him properly, she said. She couldn't possibly tell them he looked like a shadow. They think she was crazy. The next day at work, she did tell Mary though. She told her the entire story, every strange detail. Mary got a weird look on her face after hearing it all, like she thought Alice was crazy, and Alice immediately regretted saying a word. She figured she could confide in her friend, but I guess not. A few days passed, a time Alice spent worrying about this shadow man. Luckily though, he didn't pay her any further visits during this time. The time for her second date with Nick then finally arrived, a date they themselves had arranged with zero involvement from Mary. Alice wondered whether Mary had told her son anything about the whole Shadow Man affair, hoping she hadn't. If she had, he didn't reveal anything, acting exactly the same as last time. He was even more friendly now, giving her a kiss and an embrace as they greeted each other. This date was spent in a movie theater, a time they spent paying very little attention to the movie. After the movie was over, this thing continued in Nick's bedroom. And I think it's best we skip this part and leave them to their privacy. Afterwards, Alice had almost forgotten all about the Shadow Man, thanks to Nick. But, as she lay in his bed dreaming of sweet things, she was once again awoken in the middle of the night. This time it wasn't by a noise, but a sensation. A sensation running alongside her naked leg. It felt like a hand was gently caressing her leg. Alice, of course, assumed it was Nick at first, but found him lying next to her fast asleep, completely incapable of touching her leg. With blurry eyes, she looked down towards the foot of the bed, and there she saw the dark silhouette of a man sitting. He was sitting on the bed, faced her way, rubbing his hand alongside her leg. His hand was cold to the touch, and not pleasant in the slightest. Alice ripped her leg away from it and screamed. Nick woke up with a start. Confused and asking what the hell was going on, he jumped up from the bed and turned on the lights. No one, except for the two of them, were in the room. A couple of hours passed and Alice just would not calm down. She insisted there had been a man in the room, a shadow man, who had been touching her leg. Nick tried to calm her and make sense of what she was saying, but it just didn't work. As he refused to accept her claims, she eventually left the apartment. By then it was early morning, and Alice spent a few more hours just wandering the city. It was a Saturday, so no work. The entire weekend passed with no further incidents, and no calls from Nick either. She figured he'd had it, and was pulling out of the relationship before it got too serious. She must have turned out to be a giant disappointment, a complete loon. Alice wasn't sure herself. Was she insane? It all seemed insane, but at the same time felt so real. The presence of the Shadow Man, and now even his physical touch. Someone or something had touched her leg. She knew it. No hallucination could feel so real. Meanwhile, she was beginning to have even more trouble remembering her past. The old house. Jack. It was all really starting to feel like just a fantasy. Was it simply due to the passage of time? Or something else? The weekend was very lonely indeed, and she spent it mostly locked inside her small, dark apartment. Monday then came and it was time for work again, thank God. Alice did her best to keep her spirits up and played with the kids whenever she got the chance, but Mary was acting very distant. She had barely said a word to Alice since the day had begun, and even seemed to avoid her. They usually did their cleaning together, but now Mary was keeping to another part of the school. Alice knew what was going on, of course. Nick had told her about the incident at his apartment. Both of them now thought she was crazy and wanted nothing to do with her. At least she still had the kids. Halfway through the day, Alice did her rounds filling up the school's bathrooms with fresh toilet paper and replacing the trash bins. The last bathroom turned out to have malfunctioning lights. That wasn't really her job to fix, it was the custodian's. She made a mental note to tell him about it, then entered the bathroom to do her job anyway. Might as well get them all done and not leave anything for later. She left the door open to let in light from the hallway so she could see what she was doing. After she finished up and was just about to leave, she noticed something in the bathroom mirror. It was her reflection, but it was not her reflection. Where Alice Watson should have been standing, instead there stood a completely dark shadow. It was darker than the room itself, pitch black and with no features, just like the Shadow Man. It wasn't the Shadow Man though, it was her. Alice moved closer to the mirror, but no matter how close she moved, the face of Alice Watson never appeared in the reflection. It was all just a dark nothing. She couldn't believe what she was seeing. There was light coming in from the hallway outside. She could see other things in the reflection, like a roll of toilet paper she picked up and held before the mirror, but not herself. She simply wasn't there, just her shadow was. Alice panicked, ran out of the bathroom in tears, accidentally knocking over one of the kids in the hallway. There was a whole bunch of them out there waiting for a class to begin. They all stared at her while a kid on the floor began to bawl. Alice couldn't even comprehend what was happening. She stood there frozen for a while, then attempted to pick the kid up, but stopped when noticing the other children's stare. She then calmly left the school, midway through the day, abandoning all of her chores and not saying a word to anyone. Alice did not go home though. She spent the rest of the day just aimlessly roaming the city streets and parks. Little did she know she had actually been fired. After discovering what had happened, Mary went to the principal and told him everything about Alice, her crazy hallucinations and irrational behavior. That was the last straw for him. He couldn't have a maniac working at the school, interacting with the children. He tried to reach her on her phone, but it was turned off. She probably wouldn't have answered anyway. Alice walked the streets like a zombie, trying to make sense of anything that was going on. Meanwhile, her entire past had completely faded from memory. It was nothing, it had never happened. That's when she realized it. It really hadn't happened. There was no Jack, and there was no house. She had made it all up in her mind. What really had happened, and from where she truly came, began to creep back in her memory. As the sun disappeared behind the horizon and the city fell under a blanket of darkness, she knew it was true. Walking past a store window, Alice saw her reflection, a living shadow. She stopped to stare at herself, her true self. Then, finally, she decided to return home. It was pitch black in her apartment, and Alice didn't bother switching on the lights. She found a shadow man standing there in the middle of the living room, waiting for her. She knew he would be. Alice felt no fear this time. Instead, she walked up to the shadow man and embraced him. He embraced her back. The two of them reunited once again. How long it had been, she did not know. Those fake memories of Jack had jumbled everything up. Jack. The made-up brother her mind had created. This was her true brother. He had been worried about her, and naturally so. How would one react when one's sister suddenly disappeared, tried to become someone else and pretend to be human? She'd left him all alone, abandoned him, thinking of no one but herself. No wonder he came stalking after her. How horribly selfish she had been, and how naive, thinking she could ever pass off as a human. Well, it was all over now. They were reunited, and it was time to go home. Her real home. The house she used to remember was just as phony as Jack was. How do we go home, though? She asked her brother. The shadow man let go of her, entered the kitchen, and returned with something in his hand. He held it out before her. A cooking knife, its sharp blade gleaming in the darkness. Of course, she said. sometime later, no one really knows how long, the door was kicked in. It was Nick. He'd heard about what had happened at the school, and how no one could reach Alice. Feeling guilty over his treatment of her, and worrying where she disappeared to, he now came here. When no one answered the door, he decided to let himself in. Nick found the apartment completely drowned in darkness. He switched on the lights and began to search through the place, looking for any signs of Alice. With her mental state, he was prepared for the worst. And the worst was indeed what he got. Noticing the closet door standing ajar in her bedroom, he opened it and took a peek inside. There she sat, in the darkest place she could find, her wrists slit and bloodied knife lying on the floor. Nick naturally freaked out. Sure, he was prepared to meet this very sight, but you can never really prepare for something like this. Still, the man kept his cool regardless, checked Alice's pulse, and felt it was still beating, albeit very faintly. She was then rushed to the hospital, and against all odds, survived the ordeal. So with this sad little tale coming to a close, you might be wondering just why Alice Watson was sent here, to Hillbrook. We only take in criminals after all, and while suicide attempt is technically a crime, it's hardly deserving of our attention. Well, sometime later, while Alice was kept at another institution, her old family house was looked up and searched through. And yes, despite what she says, the house does actually exist. So does her brother Jack. Or rather, he did. You see, what was found in that rundown, abandoned house was a severely decomposed corpse of one Jack Watson. He was lying in his bed upstairs, covered in flies and maggots, with not much left of him for them to feast upon. Jack had, in other words, been dead for quite a while. Had there been any neighbors, they surely would have complained about the smell long ago. Anyway, Jack had been given a massive overdose of his medicine, which is what killed him. The only fingerprints found on the pill bottle were Alice's. I guess after 10 years, she just had enough. She never did get her refuge though, her own mind made sure of that. Now you'll have to excuse me. I just got word she tried to kill herself again, this time apparently with a spoon. And I specifically forbade the orderlies from giving her any cutlery of any kind, even plastic ones. I swear to God, if it's Barry again... Maybe I should just throw 471 in solitary, then she'll get her beloved darkness.